Alright, so far we've been looking at very simple linear models. So far they are very simple. We want to extend them a bit. They're simple because there are two assumptions that we were making, right? And the two assumptions are, one, that the models are additive, and two, that the models are linear, right? When I say additive, we basically mean it means the effect of changes in the predictor XJ, so changes in XJ, so that's going to be changes in XJ on response X on response Y is independent of other variables. It's independent of other variables. You remember our TV, radio, and stuff like that. We're saying, okay, cool. We put our budget in our TV. We put our budget in our TV. Although radio is doing its own thing there, when we're ignoring what radio was doing. It was there, but we're ignoring it to some extent, right? And the linear part is assuming that change in Y or change in our response due to one unit change in XJ is constant. That's what we're doing, no matter the value of XJ. We're saying no matter if we're increasing the budget by 100,000, the change in Y itself can always be predicted. It is constant. That's what we're saying. It'll be the if okay, let's say if we increase our budget from 0 to 1,000 of our TV budget, whatever TV budget, the change in Y is the same as increasing our budget from 2,000 to 3,000. From 50,000 to 51,000, because we're changing by what? By the same number of units in XJ. But is it true that when we increase our budget, our TV advertising budget, from 51,000 to 52,000, it is the same as increasing the TV budget from 0 to 1,000 with the same 1,000 change? I don't think so. So that was our linear assumption. In this video, we are going to touch on removing the additive assumption. In the next video, we'll discuss the linear assumption. So, removing the additive assumption. Removing the additive assumption, right? So, for our model with the sales and TV budget, we used a linear model with additive assumption because we assumed the effect of sales or effect on sales of increasing one advertising budget is independent of amount spent on other. We didn't care how much we really spent on radio. We're just saying, okay, whatever you spent on radio, if I increase my TV by this much, this is how the change is going to be on sales. We didn't care how much we're spending on radio, which might not be the case in real life, right? So what we would want to do is to show that sometimes, let's say we have TV and radio budgets, right? We have TV and radio budgets. This, when we remove this assumption, what we're basically saying, let's say we have 100,000, we have 100,000 to spend. What we are saying is spending 100,000 on half, let's say half we give it here, 50K we give to TV and 50K to radio. We are saying the increase in sales here is much larger than taking this 100,000 and putting it into TV or radio by itself. That's what we're basically saying. And this is only possible because of something called the synergy or interaction effect. In marketing, they call it the synergy effect. In statistics, it's called the interaction effect. Because when you put that 50,000 in the radio, it's going to also help the one on the TV. And the one on the TV is also going to help the one on the radio, right? And it's going to be different from just putting everything inside TV or everything inside radio, although we are spending the same amount. The same amount results in different increases in sales because of that interaction between TV and radio when we spend on both than when we spend on just one channel, right? So now, our usual model says Y is equal to beta naught plus beta 1 times TV plus beta 2 times radio. That is the model that we're using right now, right? This doesn't it shows no matter what value of this radio, a one unit increase in TV gives you beta 1, right? That is the base model. But we're saying that is not true. To extend it and allow for these interaction effects, we can include a third predictor. We can create a third predictor called the interaction term. So we're going to include something called the interaction term, and we're going to write our model now as beta naught plus, yes, beta 1 effect by TV, cool, plus beta 2 effect by radio, yes, but add what? Our interaction term B3 times TV times radio. And why am I saying radio? So this becomes our interaction term. It's going to be B3 times TV times radio budget. So we've added the two. We have multiplied the two, multiplied the TV and the radio and gave it a slope of its own. So now, someone might want to rewrite this to be something like beta 1 plus beta 3 times radio times TV plus beta 2 times radio. It's just rewriting and taking the TV out of these two. So it's going to be beta 1, and then from this part it's going to be B3 times radio, yeah, times TV. Now let's look at the results when we run this in R. TV, radio, and here we're going to have TV times radio, the interaction term, right? TV times radio. So I'm going to skip columns again because some of them are not useful to this discussion here. Coefficients, and I'm just going to skip to p-values. Cool. Let's look at our coefficient. The intercept coefficient is going to be 6.7502 for this one, 0.0191 for radio. It's going to be 0.0289, and for the interaction term is going to be 0.0011. And then the p-value is going to be less than 0.0001, and then less than 0.0001, and here it's going to be 0.0014, and then less than 0.0001. Cool, let's interpret that. So now, what we can see from this model, especially this second part here, the effect of increasing TV is no longer constant. It is also now being affected by radio, right? It will also be affected by the radio. So if we are to interpret what B3 means, B3 can be interpreted as the increase in effectiveness of TV advertising for one unit increase in radio advertising. If you increase this by radio advertising, or if you increase radio advertising by one unit, here, how's my TV going to change? My TV is going to change by B3 units. It's going to also going to increase by B3 units because of that interaction term there, right? The synergy effect, right? Let me look at my notes now. So this table, what does this table show us? This table shows us that the interaction term of TV and radio, this TV times radio, it is significant because look at the p-value. The p-value is significant, right? And so model with interaction term is superior to the one with only the main effects like TV and just radio by themselves. And it is clear that the true relationship is not additive. From what you've seen here, it is not additive. It has these synergy effects here. So the R squared for the original model was 89.7%. So that is the one without the TV times radio. And the R squared for this new model is now 96.8%. And if I do some calculation, so now here with 89%, right, there was some part of the data that we could not account for. And here, when we're 96.8%, there's some part of data that we now could explain. What part of that remaining part that was there originally? Because here, the remaining part that we could not explain was what? 100 minus 89%, which is let's say 11.3%. So there was 11.3% that we had no idea how to explain for before the interaction term. So what part of this 11% did we now account for when we added our interaction term? What we can now account for is 96.8, right? What can't we account for now? We have increased our R squared from 87 to 96. So basically what we have added is this, the explanation we have added, which is equal to 69, right? Yeah, 69%. So the variability that was in sales that remains after additive model has been explained by this addition of the interaction term. So when we had 11, so for the 11% that was left, 69% of that nonsense or that noise, we can explain it using this additive term. So now, increase in TV advertising by 1,000 rand is associated with what? It's going to be associated with an increase of sales of beta 1. You said what? Beta 1 plus beta 3 times radio. Cool. Beta 1 plus beta 3 times radio times 1,000, the 1,000 rand that we put there. So this is going to be equal to beta 1, which is from which is equal to it's going to be beta 1 is this one here, 1.9. So times 1,000 is just going to be 19 plus what is beta 3? Beta 3 is going to be equal to 0.11, right? Times 1,000 is going to be 1.1 times radio times whatever we are spending on radio, right? So you see now our 1,000 rand increase in TV is not just leading to beta 1, 19. It's now plus 1.1 times whatever is being spent on radio. And you can do the same for 1,000 rand increase in radio. And you find that is going to be 29 plus 1.1 times TV units. That is the increase when you spend 1,000 rand on radio. The interaction term is also going to come into play. Cool. So now there's something very important here called the hierarchical principle. This principle only states that, you see here, it's one that we are going to apply here. When we added the interaction term, our radio by itself stopped being significant, the p-value, right? But the hierarchical principle says if the interaction term is significant, the individual terms themselves are also going to be added to the model. You have to add the individual terms to the model. So in our case here, we are not going to have a model that is TV and TV times radio only because of the p-value. Now, we also have to add the radio because inside TV and radio, we have radio, and these two are definitely related. They're definitely related, right? So by the hierarchical principle, you do TV. So you do this model, this full model, even though radio here doesn't have the p-value that we're looking for. Cool. So these interaction terms, don't think they only apply to quantitative variables. They also apply to qualitative variables. How do they do that? Let's look at an example. Let's say in the credit data, we wish to predict balance using income. So we are going to predict balance using income, which is quantitative, and the student status, which is qualitative, right? So in the absence of the interaction term, this is what we are going to have. Without the interaction term, we're just going to do our student dummy variables because that is a qualitative one, right? So we are going to say maybe balance for the ith person is going to be given by beta naught plus beta 1 times income, cool, plus beta 2 if student, and then 0 if not student. I think you understand what I did here. What I basically, I created an XI. I created an XI. So I created XI, which was taking the values, what? 1 if student and 0 if not student. And I'm applied that with beta 2. So if it was beta 2, 1, then it's a student. Beta 2 times 0, which is just 0, is not a student. So this is the model that we have, right? So this can be rewritten as beta 1 times my income plus move this beta naught, it's going to be beta naught plus beta 2 if student, and then beta naught if not student, if person is not a student. Perfect, right? I think that makes so much sense. So cool. What you're seeing here, you're seeing two graphs. You're seeing two graphs. So we have this part here that says beta 1 times income plus this part plus beta naught plus beta 2, right? That is one graph. And then there's a second graph here, beta 1 times income plus beta naught, right? Plus beta naught. And can you see what if I do? Okay, let me try write them separately. So we have this first one that is saying, let me write them like this, beta naught plus beta 2 plus beta 1 times income. And then we have another one, beta naught plus beta 1 times income. These are straight line graphs. If we plot the balance by the income. So let's do that. Let's plot balance by income. So this is going to be our income level, and this is going to be our balance. For the first graph here, okay, for the non-student, because that is easier, the intercept is just going to be beta naught. So our intercept there, let me make it green. Our intercept is going to be beta naught like that. And then this is going to be non-student. With a what? With a gradient of what? Of beta 1 or a slope of beta 1. Easy stuff to see, right? I guess. I hope. I hope. And then for the first one, yeah, this one for the student people, this is the intercept, beta naught plus beta 1 plus with the gradient beta 1 naught plus beta 2 with the gradient of beta 1. So it's going to be something like this. Parallel. They are parallel because they have the same slope, although they have different intercepts, because the intercept for this one, intercept for student is beta naught plus beta 2. And then the intercept for non-student, is beta naught. It's just beta naught by itself, right? Cool. So now that we have that, let's interpret it. So when we did our, without the interaction term, let's not even think about the interaction term now. We just mixed our quantitative and our qualitative variable like that. We did the dummy variables and stuff like that. This amounted to fitting two parallel lines, one for students and one for non-students. And with the different intercepts, like I just discussed here, but the slope is the same, so they are parallel, right? The fact that the two lines are parallel, what does that mean? What it means is the average effect on a balance of one unit increase in income doesn't depend on whether or not the individual is a student. Because if we increase the income, let's say by one unit, the change in balance, because the slope is the same, it is saying the balance is the same for students and non-students. This may not be true in real life. This might not be true in real life, right? And this assumption, the one that where we didn't include the interaction term for income and the student status, has limited our model. And since it has limited our model, we can address this by including an interaction term. Let's see how we can do that. What we can do is now say my balance I is going to be now predicted by beta naught plus beta 1 times income of the ith person, of course, plus, like normal, beta 2 for the what? For the student, and 0 for the non-student, but then plus beta 3 times income. This is the interaction term that we have added, right? We have added the interaction term between my xi equal to 1 and 0 for student and non-student. That's what we have done. If the person is a student, the coding for them being a student is going to be 1, so beta 2. And if they are students, the interaction term is going to be beta 3 times income. It's going to be beta 3 times, it's actually something like beta 3 times xi. Let's say my xi is the one that is coding that, times income. That's actually how we coded it. We coded the student variable by b3 times xi times income. Times income like that, right? And this became 1 if the person is a student. So it's just b3 times income. And became 0 if the person is a non-student. So this is the equation that we have. Like previously, we can rewrite this. This is equal to beta naught plus beta 2 plus beta 1 plus beta 3 times income. Or we just have our beta naught plus beta 1 times income. So this is for students and this is for non-students. Let's plot them again. Income, balance. Cool. Our non-students are green. Okay. Let's plot our non-students. Non-students have a intercept of what? Beta naught. Beta naught with a... No, I did this wrong, right? Oh, it's correct. Okay, cool. Yeah, I want to maintain the color scheme so that you don't forget. Non-students. Our non-students have an income, have this line here with a gradient of beta 1. What about our students? Our students have an intercept of beta naught plus beta 2, like that. But the intercept is beta 1 plus beta 3. Can you see that? Beta 0 plus beta 3. So our intercept is going to be, let's see. I want to confirm something because I don't want to, for our students, it's going to have, it's going to be difficult for me to really draw to scale. Let's just say it comes out like that. I'm going to emphasize, it's because I didn't draw this to scale, so the gradients will not come out accurately, but I hope you can get what I'm trying to get at here. So now that we've included this, we have two different regression lines as for students and non-students, but they now have different slopes, right? Beta 1 and beta 3, and the other one is beta 1, and the intercepts are different as well. Beta naught and beta naught plus beta 2, right? This allows changes in income to affect students and non-students differently, right? So if our change in income is going to be like this, this change is going to be different from this change, as you can see here. This is a higher change than this change here. Cool. So slope for students is lower than slope for non-students, showing increases in income are associated with smaller increase in credit balance for students versus non-students. Cool. So basically that's what we wanted to emphasize. My slopes might be wrong, yeah, but that's what we wanted to emphasize when we're doing our interaction term. We can do the interaction term even with qualitative data, right? With qualitative, and it makes the results make even more sense. It makes the results make even more sense. There is no way change in income, it's very, I don't know, maybe it happened somewhere, but it's difficult to get changes in income to result in the same change in balance. Right? The same change in income might not result in the same change in balance. And the change in balance is the slope of these two graphs here. Cool. So in this video, we discussed the interaction terms, right? We discussed the interaction terms for us to relax that additive assumption. Now, in the next video, we're going to relax the linear assumption to see how we can introduce non-linear terms.